Everybody, Happy New Year. How you doing? Yeah, okay. That didn't sound too enthusiastic. You're not looking forward to this year? Well, welcome. My name is James Thomason. I'm the lead pastor here at Meeting House Church. And if we have never had a chance to say hello, if this is your first time with us, after the service, I will be right back there in the back corner under the words Connection Center. I would love a chance to say hello to you and just exchange names, okay? So please stop by and say hello. Now, it's the first Sunday of the new year, and it's the first Sunday of the month. And so every first Sunday of the month, we do what we call Prayer and Worship Sunday. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper today, or communion, whichever one you call it. And then we're going to have quite a bit of music. And our band is fantastic. They always do a great job leading me in worship. Then we're going to have a couple of blocks of prayer, okay? Now, I know that most of us in today's American church haven't really practiced or been a part of congregational prayer, okay? So it's okay, all right? Let me just say that to begin with. It is okay for you to pray out loud with other people in the same room. Everybody got that? Remember, Acts chapter 2 says this. They lifted their voices together, actually it's chapter 4, to prayer in God, to God. They lifted their voices together in prayer to God. So when we're going to guide you, we're going to have some themed prayer times, okay? And when you pray, just go ahead and pray out loud. It's fine. If you don't want to pray out loud, that's fine too. Okay, what I'm trying to do is just take off all the pressure and just make it very, very comfortable for you. if you want to, you can kneel, turn around and kneel at your seat and pray. I do that all the time, almost every Sunday while we're worshiping. I just spend some time in prayer right up here. During the music, if you want to listen, that's fine. If you want to raise your hands or clap, that's fine as well, okay? And we're going to, so that's prayer. We're going to pray, and we're also going to worship, okay? Now, worship means to bow ourselves before God. That's what the meaning of the word worship is, to bow before God. And so we're going to focus on Him, on who He is. So I want to encourage you to do this morning. At least for the first two-thirds of our service, I want you to take all your cares, all your worries, all your concerns, all the things that fill our minds with what we think we need from God, we need God to give us, and I want you to just set those to the side until we get to the end of the service. And prior to that, I want you to empty our minds of that, of our own self-consciousness, and we want to become God-conscious. We want to focus our minds, our hearts, our thoughts on God Himself. Okay? Sound good? You guys ready to go? I am. It's my favorite Sunday of the month, Prayer and Worship Sunday. I think it's great. We've got to get comfortable and learn to pray as a congregation. In the book of Acts, congregational prayer was an incredibly powerful force in the early church. And we here in America have gotten away from congregational prayer. We just don't do it. Okay? And so we're trying to bring that back so we can be the church that God wants us to be. All right? Let's go to God in prayer and begin. Father God, we love You. We submit ourselves to You today. We ask You, Lord, to glorify Yourself in every one of our minds and hearts, Lord. You are the God who searches minds and hearts. You know exactly what we need, exactly what's going on in our lives, exactly where we stand with You. You are a loving God who is interested in us, and we're grateful for that. But today, Lord, we want You to glorify Yourself to us. Show us how great and wonderful and glorious You are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, hey again, church, and I'm excited to be with you guys worshiping. We're going to spend a few minutes singing together, and I want to just reinforce what Pastor James said. We're not too formal here. There's no formula for you to meet with God, so do whatever do whatever you works for you to communicate with God. If you want to stand, the early church didn't all stand and stare at the stage, and we're not here for a theater church or to put on a show. We're here to meet with God, right? So stand if you want to, sit and pray, kneel, as James said, pray with who's around you, but let's worship and spend some time with God this morning. Amen. Place me on the rock that stands, and I hold true to the one who breaks my fall and lifts me time and time again. Oh my God, so good, you never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. Oh my God, so good, you never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. This freedom purchased by the highest price, this grace outweighing all my shame. And I'm made new through the power of sacrifice, from death now raised to life again. Oh my God, so good, you never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. Oh my God, so good, you never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. News, church, I hope you're thankful for it. No longer a slave to sin because of what Jesus has done for you and me. Let's sing. I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing. You are good. Buried with Christ, arise in your freedom. You are good. When you make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. You are good. So I'll praise your name as long as I'm breathing. You are good. I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing. You are good. Buried with Christ, arise in your freedom. You are good. When you make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. You are good. So I praise your name as long as I'm breathing. You are good. And Lord Jesus, thank you for the good news, the gospel that we just sang about, Lord, that even though we sinned against you and you didn't have to, you sent your son so that we could have a right relationship with you in eternal life and hope that starts today and now in this life. So God, we thank you for all you've done for us, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can have a seat.
Well, what I'd like to do first this morning is to tell you how Jesus Christ can set you free. And if you have turned to him and put your faith in him as your Lord and Savior, then I want you to know that you have been set free from sin. So the first passage of Scripture we're going to look at today is 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And it'll be on the screen for you if you don't have a Bible and don't want to and can't turn there, but it is the gospel, the good news about Jesus Christ in a very condensed form. It's everything that we need to know in order to be right with God and believe. And let's read it together. Well, you don't have to read, but let's read it. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the Spirit, or by the Spirit. So Christ suffered once for sins. God created every one of us. He created the first man and the first woman, Adam and Eve, and every other human being who's come into existence. God created every one of us to live in relationship with him. I want you to know that that is why you exist, because God created you to live in relationship with him. God had nothing but good intentions, nothing but the highest of desires, the best in his heart and his mind in creating us and allowing us to have life and sustaining us. But every one of us, from our very first parents, Adam and Eve, up until now and on to into the future, every one of us has rejected God's purpose for creating us, which is to live in relationship with him, to know him, to love him, to worship him, to serve him, and to be loved in return, I mean, prior to that, by him, to know God. Every one of us has rejected that. And that is what the Bible calls sin. And sin separates us from God. It breaks off the relationship that God created us to live in and enjoy with him. Right? The Bible tells us the wages of sin is death. Isaiah chapter 59 says, your sins have separated you from your God so that he will not hear you. So in one way, so God created us to live in relationship with him, to love you and for you to love him back, to enjoy you and for you to enjoy him back. And he gave us life, and every one of us has said, no, thank you, God. I want to do my life on my terms, my way, not yours. And everything that we call sins are just a result of that. Lying, cheating, stealing, betraying, all these other things. They're just the result of saying no thank you to God. But because of God's great love, his redeeming love, God looks at each one of us and says, I've created you to love me, to know me. I've created you to love you, to allow you to know me, to live in relationship with me. And although you've rejected me, I have redeeming love for you. I want to buy you back to myself, God says, to be in relationship with me in this life and forever. And so Christ died once for sins. When Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on the cross, the Bible tells us that he became guilty of our sin. He who knew no sin became sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So Christ died once for sins. He died once on the cross for all sins, for all time, past, present, future. For every human sin, Christ suffered the justice of God on the cross in payment for that. All of yours, all of mine. Everything I've done against God in the past, everything I've done against him in the present, and everything I will do, hopefully very few, but in the future, once for sins. The righteous for the unrighteous. Did you know that righteousness is required for a relationship with God? Right? Sin is the loss of righteousness. It's the rejection of righteousness. God is righteous. He is good. He is kind. He is holy. He is loving. And every one of us has rejected righteousness, God's righteousness. We have become unrighteous. God's word tells us that Christ was tempted, and we'll look at this later on, in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. Yet without sin. Jesus went through every kind of trial, every struggle, every hardship in life that you experience. He was tempted to reject God, just as you have been tempted to reject God and rejected God, but Jesus never did. He remained, as the Bible says, a spotless lamb, free of sin, so that he could take on our sin, so that he could become our sin and pay that price for us in his death on the cross. Why did he do it? To bring us to God, to redeem us, to bring us back to God. You know, so often we think about the greatest gift that Jesus gives us is forgiveness, right? Who doesn't rejoice in the fact that we are no longer guilty for the wrongs that we have done, right? It is a wonderful thing to literally have the weight of sin lifted off you, right? It is. Man, when the day I became a believer, I was born again, I felt light, man. I felt like I lost 30 or 40 pounds. And I was in college, I didn't have any fat to lose, you know what I mean? It was the weight of sin, right? It was the weight of sin to bring us to God. So forgiveness is a wonderful thing, right? It's a wonderful thing to know that the weight of sin is no longer on us. But that is not the greatest gift that God gives us. Forgiveness is really just a means to an end. God forgives our sin. He takes it away. He blots it out. He wipes it out. He deletes it, the Bible says, so that we can be in relationship with him. The greatest thing that God has given you, because you have put your faith in his Son, is not forgiveness. It's himself. God has given you himself through the gospel. God is the greatest thing. You now have a relationship with him. You can now at any moment bow your heart, your mind, your body, wherever, whenever you are, in spirit, in silence, or out loud, and enter into God's presence and speak with him. You have a direct access to God. He will never count your sin against you anymore. Your life began with God the moment you turned to him, and it will last forever into eternity. Eternal life began the moment you trusted Christ, not the moment you'll die. To bring you to God. What a wonderful thing. He was put to death in the body, right? But he didn't stay there. Christ died. He had our sin on him. He died. He descended into the grave, into hell, and he took our sin there and left it and rose victorious over it, right? To give us new life and forgiveness. This is the gospel. We receive it by faith, by trusting, by believing, by repenting, by turning from our life that we've been living away in from God's purpose back to him, acknowledging that Jesus is God's son who did what we've just described and who alone can give us life with God and wants to. And the moment we do that, we're born again into God's family. We're adopted. We become a child of God, as we sang. So there is the good news that God has for you today. Amen. Now, before we receive the Lord's Supper communion, let me just ask so we have time. Did everyone get a communion cup? I'm sorry, we're still using the hermetically sealed stuff, but, you know, our COVID demands it. So if you don't have one of these, raise your hand and one of our ushers will get you one, okay? Just raise your hand and we'll get those, okay? All right? Now, before we receive the Lord's Supper, God's word tells us to take time for self-examination and confession of sin, okay? So we're going to have just a short time here. I just want you to ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you anything you need to confess to him, anything you need to turn away from. Just confess it. Confessing means just tell the truth, right? Just say the truth to God. God has forgiven you. He's already died for these sins and risen again, right? Just ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you whatever it is that you need to confess, or you might know it already. Probably you do. And just confess it. Receive God's forgiveness. And after we've had a time, then Caleb's going to play over that, and then I'll come back up and we'll receive the Lord's Supper together, okay? All right. Father God, we thank you for the gift of confession. Your word says, Lord, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. God, I thank you for that. Thank you so much. If we claim to be without sin, we make you out to be a liar and your truth has no place in us, Lord. We thank you. that when we do sin, we have an advocate, Jesus Christ the righteous, who speaks to you, Father, in our defense. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Not only for ours, Lord, but for the sins of the whole world. We praise you and thank you for that. That we can rest in your grace and forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul recounts how to celebrate the Lord's Supper for us. And he says this, the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. Right? That's what we call, he's at what we normally call in our culture the Last Supper. He's eating with his disciples the night before one of his disciples, Judas, betrays him and turns him into the authorities. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, I apologize for the awkwardness, but let's take a moment and go ahead and open up the top layer of your cup there. It's transparent. It's a thin layer, and we'll grab that. So the bread we eat represents Christ's body, pierced, beaten, stabbed with a sword, with a spear, in payment for our sins. Thank you, Father God, for the gift of your Son. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love for the Father and for us, that you would sacrifice yourself, allow yourself to pay the price for our sin. Lord, we thank you in your name. Amen. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. The new covenant, the new relationship that God has given you, that God offers you through his Son, Jesus Christ, that he will forgive your sins and remember them no more. That he will write his law on your mind and in your heart. That you will become his child, be his son or daughter. Filled, indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Given eternal life. That's the new covenant that God has made with you. The new relationship. So this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, right? The gospel, the gift of God. Let's spend some time praising him now, okay? And I'll go ahead and dismiss the children. Kids, MHC kids will begin now. If you're here with your parents, your teacher will meet you in the back of the auditorium and take you down.
A better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. Let's sing that again. Your blood. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. What can wash away our sin? What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can testifies in grace, tells of the Father's heart to make a way for us. Now boldly we approach, not earthly confidence. It's only by your blood. What can let's sing this hymn together. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. How precious is been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when let's sing Amazing Grace one more time, church. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves a wretch like me.
Hey, go ahead and grab a seat. We're going to take a moment just to focus our minds and our hearts on God. And I just want to read a selection from Psalm 145 today. And then we're going to give you time to worship again. Okay? And again, let me encourage you. If you came with somebody, pair up and pray. Worship God together. If you didn't, that's fine. Worship God on your own. You make yourself at home and comfortable. Okay? Psalm chapter 145, and let me just encourage you, if we could just get this constant picture in our minds of who God is and what He's like, because this is who He is and what He's like, it would revolutionize your life. It would revolutionize your attitude. It would revolutionize your confidence in God. It would revolutionize what you see God do in your life because you would have more faith in Him. So we're going to read this, and then I've taken it and turned it into a prayer. And if you need that, if you want to use it, it'll be up on the screen after we're done. If not, you just go ahead and praise God. We want to be conscious of God here right now. We want to focus our minds on who He is and what He's like. So Psalm chapter 145 says this, I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. Your dominion endures through all generations. Folks, God reigns. God reigns on the earth. He is king over the nations of the earth. The Lord is trustworthy in all His promises and faithful in all He does. Faithful and trustworthy. The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. Is that you this morning? God will lift you up. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. The truth is, folks, God feeds every one of us and every living thing from the palm of His hand. Every good thing we have is a generous gift of God. What a picture. The Lord is near to all who call on Him, to all who call on Him in truth. Do you feel like God's far away? Call out to Him in truth. Be honest. Be honest with Him. Call out to Him in accordance with His word, in agreement with it. The Lord watches over all who love them, but all the wicked he will destroy. God is just. God is just. What a wonderful picture of God. Let's bring the prayer up based on that. And basically what I did is I do this all the time. I have big portions of scripture that I've just over time just memorized, and I just turn them into prayers between me and God. And so what I've done is personalize this for you if you want to use it. So I just want you to spend some time praising and worshiping God. What is praising God? It's telling God how wonderful he is. It's telling God who he is and how wonderful he is. So let's do that together. As I said, feel free to praise him out loud. You don't have to worry about who's listening. If you want to pray, if you want to kneel, whatever it is you want to do, you focus your mind and heart on God and worship him, okay? God, we love you and praise you. God, you are so, so good, unfathomably good. God, so good we do not have words to describe it, Lord. So, God, I pray you would fill our mouths with your praise.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the water holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in space between what remains of me and its reckoning. Either way, I will bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire standing next to me. There is another in the waters holding back the sea. Should I ever need reminding what power set me free? There is a grave that holds nobody. Now the power lives in me. There is another in the fire.
Another in the waters, holding back the sea.
sing about today, again, that you are always with us, no matter what we're facing, no matter how big it seems, no matter how horrible a situation we find ourselves in, Lord, you're with us, and your word says that we have a high priest in Jesus Christ who can relate to our needs and our temptations, Lord, and so we thank you for that, Lord. Well, help us to just understand that in our day-to-day, and just to look to you. Lord, draw us closer to you, Lord, with this truth in mind. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hebrews, there we go. 4:14-16. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are. Yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne with grace and confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. We're going to take a time to bring our request to the Lord.
Spend a few minutes praying. If you want to gather up with friends or family, share what's on your heart. Be honest. Share your requests, whether it's big or small. God cares. Let's pray. All right, church, keep praying if you're praying. I don't want to interrupt you. Keep doing what you're doing. We're going to sing a little bit more. We've had a great time just meeting with the Lord this morning, and I want to encourage and challenge us, including myself. You know, it doesn't end at 11:30 or whatever time. You know, let's seek God this week, in this new year, this opportunity we have to kind of pursue Him with more energy and more passion. And so I want to encourage you with that. We're going to sing and celebrate one more time just how good God is, what He's done for us. So let's sing again and close. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.